states?
Candy. How are you supposed to go after candy illegal because a fucking pedo in a van might buy candy?
You can't sell candy to pedophiles if you know they're going to use it to lure children into the house. Like, it seems pretty straightforward.
We've gone down this rabbit hole before of like where you randomly and arbitrarily make laws, right?
One, Google has a rocky relationship with China. It has removed most of its services from the mainland. This is partly due to the censorship regulations that China imposes on all tech firms. But should Google have ever been expected to resist China's laws? The companies always focus on maximizing profits, even if that means working with distasteful parties. And are the people of China worse off without Western services? So what inspired this is an article saying that Google Translate was removed, so like you can't access it on Chinese mainland, and like can't access most of its services. They're gone. Google at least says it's doing it because it, you know, doesn't want to be evil, I guess. Doesn't want to assist China. I have thoughts on Google and its track record on civil liberties. Should any of that matter, to a profit maximizing corporation? Was it foolish? And is it better just to try to give audiences in repressed regions access to Western services? They might find something that is normally disallowed. So I know we'll jump into it. We'll start with our friend Bam.
Ooh, I got to go back to back. Specifically with this, I think that people always, like, we always try to frame these things in the easy, like the very simple overlay of like we're always maximizing profit, which is only true within a degree. It's not necessarily about profit today. It's about like businesses have to track things that relate to a long game. And I can understand why in the like long game, it's beneficial for Google to decide that like, oh, okay, you know, we're going to make some type of stance on our opinions on dealing with China. I'm sure this isn't going to be like a long lasting permanent move, but I think it makes sense for right now. I think that's one of the benefits of being such a large corporation is you can make decisions like this and still be extremely profitable. So, I don't think this is necessarily against Google's interest to do so.
Did you say my name? Sorry,
I said Scott.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my bad. So in a free market, it is always the business's duties to make as much profit as possible for its shareholders, right? Because that is what society values. That is what people value. And in a free market, a truly free market, profit is just proper resource allocation and interest paid towards land and labor for products and services that people need. The problem is when you have a mixed market economy, sometimes what's best for profit is regulatory capture, working with companies that are doing things that are fraudulent or involve some form of theft or involve some sort of like kind of tipping the scales in one direction or another. And so when asked like, should a company maximize its profit? Well, they should always, to the best of their ability, assuming that that doesn't violate anybody else's rights. Now, Google has a really sketch history of working with China in the past, right? You know, they built search engines for them to censor. Obviously, Google censors their search engine here in America based upon political values that help the establishment and their own personal values. But they did the same thing in China. And of course, in 2010, China hacked them, stole their IP and pissed them off. And they said, well, we refuse to censor now, and got kicked out. Google went in 2017, I believe, and built an AI lab. And of course, they pulled out in 2019. Google did some work with Tencent, and of course those deals fell through. So now Google's removing Translate, and you go, well, what's going on here? Well, the fact of the matter is that China's becoming less of a free market. They're stealing more. They're tipping the scales towards their own companies more. you know, they're having runs on the banks where they have training exercises to protect the money in the banks, right? And so I think what we're seeing isn't so much Google doing the right thing or, you know, trying to not be evil. They're just maximizing their profits like they've always been doing. And the cool thing about capitalism is the less capitalistic you get, you may get some short temporary gains, but eventually it doesn't work out in your favor. And this is why Google's pulling out, because it's no longer profitable for them to be there. It's not helping their business at all. It's just opening up vulnerabilities for them. I think it's hilarious and base that the Google Translate, when you click it, links to a Hong Kong website and then lets you know that that website's blocked. So then like mainland China people that attempt to use the product are like, oh, they have this freedom in Hong Kong. You just don't get it. Which I think is just hilarious. But like, ultimately I would say, yes, it is in a business's interest to maximize profits, but you shouldn't do so in a way that violates other people's rights. That China obviously does that, but that ultimately the balance between free markets and mixed market economies, that the more socialistic an economy is, eventually that catches up with them. And the profit incentive kind of tends to go in the favor of not violating people's rights anyways. The two simply align at a certain point.
Thank you, Sam. Corey?
So I don't know that I have an exact firm position on this. That might just be due to ignorance, because I would say I'm not well-versed in terms of like all of Google's dealings with China. Definitely probably not as well-versed as Scott, since a lot of the information that Scott shared is new to me. What I would say is I think I overlap in terms of the sentiment of like, should companies maximize profits provided they don't violate human rights? I would say yes, I agree with that sentiment, but obviously I think Scott and I have very clear different definitions of rights. And I think that's more or less my bottom line, my guiding principle. But I'm more or less like, I'm open-minded and I'm willing to sort of like stake out a more, I guess, firm position based off what other actual panel members say. Because again, I'm pretty open and I don't think this is exclusive to Google. And to answer sort of the question in the prompt of like, are the people of China worse off without Western services? As far as I can tell, but I'm far from an expert, I don't think so, because I think China is pretty much moving, or at least trying to move in the direction of being self-sufficient based off of the information in the article. They already have their own translating service and they already have their own search engines, et cetera. And they are like, I think they're moving towards being self-sufficient as far as I can tell. So I think they don't really care all that much about Western services. That's pretty much it so far.
Nice, Joe.
Yeah, I mean, Google's going to do what it wants. I do think, generally speaking, companies are providing some type of service, and they feel like certain actors are not going to use their services in a way that they feel is consistent with whatever they value, then I think it's totally fine for them to pull out. If I'm China in this case, it's just making sure the alternatives are available for citizens to use. It's a shame that we're at a position where pulling out of an ecosystem or pulling out of an area could be potentially really huge for a region, but I wish we were in a better position for that. But generally speaking, I think the long-term solution would be to make sure that the alternatives to Google are really solid, so that people aren't like 100% relying on the services if Google were to decide to pull out for whatever reason.
Back to it.
So, Prime, I actually also have a problem with Google, and it kind of goes along with something I realized, and this is a tip also to everybody out there. If you're ever debating a left-winger and you know that you've seen a study that just completely destroys their point, but you can't find it on Google, just switch over to Bing. And I promise you that if you put in the right keywords, you'll find it within a few seconds. I can't prove it. I'm convinced that Google is actively trying to censor like right-wing or libertarian positions here. Because I've just noticed it again and again and again, every single time, you know, whenever I'm looking up anything that's controversial, that's not the left-wing perspective, I just simply can't find it. I can find it on Bing within a few seconds. So just a quick tip to everybody out there. Regardless of these issues, I'm going to praise Google here. I don't think Google or any companies of any Western countries should be doing business in China or should be aligned with China or should have investments in China. We are selling the bullets which will be used to shoot down the birds of liberty of the free peoples in this world. We are selling the bullets to our enemy. I think this is an example of a market failure. If a business makes money by engaging in an enterprise which promotes bad, such as selling guns to terrorists or providing economic expansion of communists, this business needs to be stopped in the name of global freedom and the sustainability of capitalism. I'm glad that Google did it willingly. I would be in favor of stopping, you know, it would be difficult, but hopefully stopping all economic engagement with communist countries in this world.
Ah, tell us how you really feel. Thank you so much, Lactoid. Let's go to Ginger.
Well, I kind of agree with Corey on this. I don't know whether it's just like maybe lack of knowledge on it or anything. I don't have a very firm stance on it. I don't feel like they are doing it for a like any charitable reason or any good reason. I'm sure they're doing it all for profit reason and for business purposes. Do I feel like they'll hinder themselves without us? No. I think that, like he said, that they're creating their own, I mean, they have their own Facebook type things, they have their own like Twitter type things anyways. They've been censored from everything else. I don't think that Google Translate is going to be that big of a difference.
Spartacus.
So Google is, they're doing this for the face of it. They're doing this for the face of the value to try and have the people who want to use Google, say, look, Google's doing a good thing. Google's pulling out of China. When the truth of it is that Google would be just fine staying in China if they're making money. But the truth of the matter is that Google's not making money in China. And they're moving out of China and to try to further pursue, more money. And no, I don't think that companies have the right to just go around doing whatever they can to lift the bottom dollar. And an example I'll give for this is Mylan and Pfizer. When Mylan took over, the distribution and the marketing for the EpiPen soared from $100 to $650 for an EpiPen. This severely hurt people that have like anaphylactic shock when it comes to allergies, whether it be peanuts, bees, whatever it is you're allergic to. If you experience anaphylactic shock, an EpiPen is something that is needed to try and get you enough time to get to the hospital. And so, no, I don't think that in all cases that a company is trying to make more money should try to make more money. I think there are moral dilemmas to where the company has to go. This isn't the right choice because this is going to put people in a bad position. Now, when it's a very like a luxury item, I don't see an issue with charging more money. But when it's something that's needed for like the sustainment of life, then I do see an issue with a company deciding like, oh yeah, we're going to do this just to make more money.
Thanks so much. And last but not least, Doobie, please.
I think that what's interesting to me about this is that it's basically like seeing a clash between two competing overlords, right? In the culture war, you have China, who has a very, obviously they have like their very specific set of preferences for how they'd like to see the culture develop. You have Google, who has their own very specific set sets of preferences for how they'd like to see a culture develop. Like Lactoid pointed out, Google definitely takes steps to censor some ideas, facts, ideologies, etc. All over the fucking internet, and it's beyond just like their search engine. They do this in everywhere. They have the ability to do this, right? All these tech companies do this. I mean, we just saw Andrew Tate unpersoning happening. This also just happened to Sneeko like yesterday, I think, or is it earlier today?
Today.
So they do this not because they think these people are dangerous. It's because these people are conflicting with the worldview. So I think we need to kind of throw away the idea that Google is doing this because they're taking some principled position on censorship or freedom of speech or whatever the fuck. I don't think it's that at all. I think just China's worldview conflicts with their worldview. And so you have two sets of people that would like to brainwash the people in China, competing and conflicting, and that's what this is. Like, and I wonder if we're okay with that, right? So we can point to China and say, hey, China wants to censor all these ideas, and they want to censor these websites and et cetera, because they don't want their people to interact with things that they'd consider to be like a counterculture, or to be like to undermine their like authoritarian positions or whatever. But given that we have all these tech companies in the United States that do exactly the same thing, like it seems like the corporate overlord meme isn't, like, it's not a meme anymore. It's a real fucking thing. And they're definitely exerting their influence on the culture. So I wonder how we can point the finger at China. Like, hey, you're bad. You're terrible for doing this stuff. When the person that we're meant to be praising in the story is doing exactly the same shit here.
Okay. Open to the panel. Anyway,
I'm gonna agree. I'm gonna agree with Dibby that it's not this is not like some kind of moral, like, oh, we're gonna do this because it's the right thing. This is simply just playing it off as that they were losing money in China. They were losing money trying to compete in China. So they're pulling out of China. They're tired of the censorship they're having to do for China. They're tired of having to add all these extra things. It's costing Google money, and Google's tired of wasting their money on this when they could be focused on other things. So they're pulling out of China because of the monetary value that is outside of China is much more valuable than the restrictions they have inside of China. And they're trying to play it off as some kind of, like, moral good, as if they're doing this for the morals. They're not doing this for the morals. They're doing this because of the bottom dollar.
So I want to agree with Sporadicus halfway. I don't know that they're necessarily advertising or, like, marketing that they're doing this for a moral good. I think they just did it. And, you know, they probably leaked it to the email so they could get some positive, I mean, like, leaked it to the press so they could get some positive press. But it's not like there's, like, commercials being run, like, Google went out and said, like, for a better world, we stopped working with, you know, the Chinese censorship, or, right? Like, I think they just did it. But like you said, because they're not making money, I think the biggest proof of this is probably Project Dragonfly, right? So even after 2010, when Google pulled out of their search engine, well, technically, they didn't pull out, you know, a couple of Chinese companies. I think it was Baidu, you know, somehow magically got their IP after they were hacked by Chinese. And it pissed off Google. So Google said, well, OK, you want to fucking hack us? We're not going to censor anything. And then they were immediately kicked out. But from 2017 to 2019, they were working on Project Dragonfly, which was a group of specific people in-house that they tried to keep secret, that they were developing a search engine that would fit all of the parameters that the Chinese wanted. They abandoned that project, and they didn't abandon that project even when they got bad press. They abandoned that project later, right? And so they doubled down by putting an AI research lab so that they could collaborate with the Chinese with DeepMind. And I think what they're realizing is that private property rights are being eroded further in China, towards the point where China is benefiting their own corporations and not respecting private property. And so they're not going to be able to make any money. And so that's why they're fucking pulling out, because the profit incentive isn't there, because China's becoming too totalitarian. They're not doing this because they give a fuck about Uyghurs or something, right? Like, they're doing this because they're not making money, but lo and behold, it's the socialism that makes it difficult for them to make the money. So I want to say that. The second thing I want to say is Lactoid, Bing is actually the only search engine from the West that is still in China and specifically censors themselves for the Chinese government. Google and Yahoo have already left, etc. If you want to know whether or not something is censored on Google, a great way to test something, along with using Bing or Yandex or, you know, other, or DuckDuckGo or other search engines.
Ask Jeeves.
DuckDuckGo admitted that they also sometimes censor, you know, certain things. Go to Start Page, and what Start Page will do is, it is still Google, but it doesn't have the algorithm based off of your IP address to select certain things for you, right? So sometimes things are censored on Google, and then sometimes things are censored, but they're not really censored. It's just giving you what it thinks it wants you to have, based off of, like, what you click on the most. And so Start Page is a good way to kind of, like, reference those things.
I want to ask also to follow up on that, towards Lactoid. So you alluded to sort of just what Scott's outlined of, like, you seem to work under the assumption or the hypothesis that Google is censoring certain ideas. Like, how, so what do you count as censorship in that point? Because how do you know that it's just not a hit that's buried? Like, have you gone, when you search for something, do you go through 20, 30 pages deep?
How's that not censorship?
Yeah. So first of all, I did not know Bing was active in China. That's disturbing and disappointing. I thought they were better than that. But you know,
sometimes you hear
Microsoft.
Always known to
Microsoft.
Yeah. I know. I was, maybe it was a fucking pipe dream. I was like, oh look, they can do it. Why can't Google? Yada, yada. Okay. All
right. You wanted it, man. I'm sorry.
I know. No, you wanted it. Santa Claus isn't real. I get it.
I know. So it sucks.
I have to deal with that. But I think when I'm typing in the exact search terms that I know should bring this up, and you bury it to the point where I'm five pages in and I can't find it, I think this is essentially censorship.
Right? But isn't that how Google, like, so this is just me thinking out loud, isn't that how Google works? Of like, you know,
Corey,
go ahead, Spartacus. Yeah,
you know that when Twitter specifically blocks people from like seeing your Twitter post, it's considered shadow banning. They're not banning you; they're just making sure you're not getting the reaction that you're used to getting. They are making it very hard to retrieve your content, and so it's considered shadow banning when they do that. Do you not consider the same thing for Google as to someone making it very, very hard for someone to get an actual source as to shadow banning that source?
You think Google's intentionally shadow banning?
Can I answer, please, that question? So I think there's something, there's a difference, a clear difference in my mind between Twitter and Google, but also at the same time, it depends on what you're searching for, because you know, if I'm searching for an academic article, I would never go to Google, just because the way they curate and their algorithm is just like totally different. And like, at least based off what I know of how Google works, it's curated content, and like what shows up at the top is not necessarily there's a reason why it shows up at the top, and it might be monetarily, a monetary reason or whatever. And I don't know that it's censorship, or at least as far as I can tell.
So then you just don't know how to use Google. I can literally use quotation marks, which will put so the quotation marks in Google is supposed to give me the results with that exact phrase in it. And I would still be several pages deep before I find the exact source that I'm wanting, even though it has that in quotation marks, where it would show me other links that is similar to my quotation marks, right? But then like five pages deep, I find the source that has my exact quotation marks, which should have been way above the similar in quotation marks.
Yeah, and I can make the same argument for academic databases. But and as far as I know, maybe I could be wrong, but academic databases like PubMed, JSTOR, SciFinder, they don't go. I wouldn't call that censorship. That just may be into the algorithm.
You know, Google Scholar exists, right?
I don't really like. Well, at least for my purposes, Google Scholar is not that great.
I mean, for your specific field, right? Yeah. But like, if you're looking for general information and research that has a large amount of citations, so you can get an idea of like what the research states, Google Scholar is pretty much one of the best.
Depending on your this is just a difference.
I'm just throwing that out there. I'm trying to defend Google. Like, fuck Google.
So it sounds like the variation of the same. It sounds like a variation of the same thing that Corey just said, though. I don't know what that adds. But you were saying something about that, Corey. Like, why isn't why isn't Google Scholar good for you relative to your field?
Just because in terms of like this specific discipline that I'm in, and the type of topics that I mentioned, like Google Scholar is just like not that great. That's all. But it's
okay.
Just for me personally, and my specific field, the biological mm-hmm. sciences, like PubMed and SciFinder is way more useful for me.
Bam, you were going to push back on something, and then I also do want to jump on Doobie's point. I thought Doobie had an interesting point at the start, but Bam, you want to?
Yeah, I don't know. I think that I think they have like 2,000 different factors into their algorithm. Like, it was some ridiculous number, but like I feel like we're dealing with like kind of conspiracy stuff, because I think the biggest factors in something is when you search something is one. How many people who search this thing up have like used this link in the last 30 days? Some level of relevance to the topic that you displayed. And then there's certain websites that are considered that are just going to be listed higher in Google because of the type of website it is. Like if you're CNN.com is going to be, if you're looking for a site, something, CNN is probably going to be higher on the thing, and not because it's a left-wing source, but just because it's like a major news, you know, website. Like, yeah, and like I said, there's a bunch of other factors, but I feel like that's the three of the main things that's targeted into anything you Google, like, because it's just more useful that way. versus saying like, I want to find this niche. Like I can understand it can be hard to find a niche thing that like you and 20 other people with tinfoil hats have found useful to look at. Like, so, that's just not what the average person would be looking for when they search
up. So what you're saying is it's curated content that is a form of censorship.
So,
because CNN's ratings he won't have it. Go ahead, Spartacus.
CNN's ratings has consistently gone down. Less people are clicking on CNN links. Less people are watching CNN on TV. Their ratings have consistently gone down, but yet it is still one of the first sources you'll see when you look something up on Google. There's been several times, I can't name exact times, but there's been several times that I've intentionally tried to see how long it took me to get Fox News. It was 3 full scrolls over on news for me to see Fox News. I'm not saying I agree with Fox News, but what I'm saying is Fox News is a very big news corporation in America, and for a very big news corporation in America to be 3 swipes over, that's absolutely insane. That you're going to show me all the other things, but you're three swipes over, and now I hit my first Fox News article.
For what topic?
I also want to point out
it was just general topics. I'm not saying I agree with Fox News, but what I was intentionally trying to see where Fox News was, and it took me 3 swipes to get there.
I'm saying, you think I can't search something right now when Fox News come up as the first
it's not gonna be the first one though.
I mean, you do realize, as far as like it's censored by whatever country and language. Like when you're putting in Google, like I'm sure you're not getting articles. You're getting United States or largely American or United States, North American content, or whatever Western content. So I mean, is that censorship to you, Lactoid?
Well, I don't know why we're debating whether or not Google censors, because this is like just a known fact at this point. This is silly and stupid, but, sure, but like, for example, Steven Crowder did a whole thing where, you know, he would Google himself and certain videos that he had put out, could not find them. But when he went to other countries that he wasn't in throughout all of Europe, he could find them because it was specifically censoring his videos, even when he was typing in the exact title of the video in the United States, but wasn't in other places. Like this, like I find this silly and stupid that anyone, like, just accept it. Everybody knows we this is already just a fact of reality. Like,
for example,
why we're getting, like, the topic is about China, and it seems like people don't want to have that conversation. They want to argue about something that everybody already knows is true.
But you're arguing about the intention of it.
Yeah, well,
I'm not just arguing about the intention of it. I'm saying that there's a bias of some sort, that the results are that, like, conservative and libertarian views, despite how popular they may or may not be, are much harder to find, and that information is much more difficult to find than left-wing sources, even when you have a search, when you put in keywords that should give you the exact thing you're looking for.
He's right. Hidden.
Find tons of other stuff. It's just silly.
He's right. I mean, and this is like an obscure reference, but I mean, it really hits home, because try to, and I know everybody's going to be irritated, but try to look up Cozy TV on Google, and it will not come up unless you put Cozy TV Nick Fuentes.
I don't need the FBI seeing me searching that.
But here's the thing. I googled Trump. That's literally what I googled. I just googled Trump.
You got Trump card as your answer?
Well, no, I'm now on the 14th page, and I still haven't seen one article from Fox News. I'm now on the 15th page, and I've still not seen one article from Fox News.
Well, the funny thing is that the Reuters, AP, and Fox are the only 3 major media publications in America that have their own wire, right? So, like, you would think it would bias and favor Fox News over any other mainstream media outlet just by virtue of the popularity, which crushes all of the other people's numbers, and the fact that they have their own wire. So they tend to be the first to report on things, and CNN, MSNBC, ABC, etc., tend to pull their news from Fox, because they have their own fucking wire. So, like, the idea that Fox shouldn't be one of the first things that pops up is just hilarious. Now, again, Sprouticus, I would say maybe check start page, because it might just be that you tend to click links from CNN, MSNBC, ABC before. And, like, start page will give you more of an idea of just, like, what Google is in general, as opposed to, like, what is curated for you. But, I mean, even that is kind of, like, problematic, I think, if if Google is like curating the news for you, even if that's not censorship, you could see how like that could lead to echo chambers.
So, I mean, I guess on the start page, I see it in the first page. It's like, it's six down, but like on Google, like it's, I'm on the 22nd page and it's nowhere to be found. There's no more than 22 pages. Like I literally looked it up on Google. There's no Fox News articles, regarding that.
Yeah. I mean like, but okay. So, yeah, Google has its preferences. Like we can see this on YouTube, where previously independent news sites were or channels were growing exponentially because you know they were popular. They had people coming to them, and you know on all sides of the spectrum. But then Google made a change and privileged established news sources like CNN, NBC, and the rest.
The term is. Authoritative sources.
That's authoritative, yes. Thank you for that. Authoritative
people who
sources.
Consistently and get it wrong or authoritative.
All of a sudden, their views shot up, right? And then others could not. Their channels just wouldn't grow, right? People who had been doing it for years, all of a sudden there was like you could see a graph, and their new followers like went off a cliff, because that's just what YouTube/Google decided to do. But then this all gets to our friend Doobie, who made a point at the very start talking about, okay, if we've established, and we just have, that Google has some level of censorship, is it any different from China doing that, right? China very publicly, right, has the great firewall of China, and they block out content they find objectionable. So if they're doing it, like, is China so bad?
I mean, China's at least being public about it.
Probably not in China.
And if I could actually ask or clarify Lactoid's position, because based off of your opening statement, which you said earlier, it seems like you want, like, pretty much, like, all like whatever Western companies to have no dealings at all with China. You want them to very much like be isolated. Is that correct?
Yeah. So I think China's worse than Google. But going back on my like talking about the point a little bit. You know, a lot of it was just based on. You know, I've been looking up some stuff while we've been talking. There seems to be some evidence to suggest that yeah, it's true. They were fined by the EU in 2018 for manipulating search results, billions and billions of dollars. They have blacklists, they're doing all this stuff. And for me, like it just seems so consistent that every time I'm discussing something with somebody and I cannot find something on Google, well, hold on, like this is a, you know, a topic in which I'm representing a right-wing position, I have to use a different search engine. Oh, wow, first page, right? And so this is useful to me. I'm gonna keep doing that because it serves utility. And I would suggest that other people do it too. As to China being worse than Google, yeah, I think this is inarguable, right? However frustrated I am with Google, I mean, here we have a state actor that represents 1.4 billion people that censors to a far greater degree than Google does, right? Censors anything that challenges the state regime. And they have an army behind the central ruling Communist Party. The army is actually not loyal to the country of China. That's an interesting little factoid. They're loyal to the party. So it'd be like if the U.S. military wasn't loyal to the country, it was loyal to like the Democrats. That's the comparison here, how crazy it is over there. But not only do they have a military, not only are they, you know, a state actor hell-bent on, you know, global expansion and authoritarian control, but they've also demonstrated I think when they do get control, some very disturbing tendencies about what they do to their civilian populations that are, I think in every way just makes them worse. This is not comparable. So do I think that we should ban Western countries from dealing with Google? No, I don't think they're a threat to global liberty in the same way I think China is. And by doing business with China, really any company doing business with China, I think we're selling them, you know, there's a thing that I hear from leftists sometimes, like the capitalists are going to sell us the rope that we're going to like use to hang them. And it's a horrible saying, right? Because it's disgusting. But I think with China, I feel like we're doing that, right? We are selling them the bullets that they're going to use against us. We're selling them the power that they're using to destroy us. Why are we doing this? Why are we okay with this?
Well, as far as I can tell, at least my understanding is like many Western, like, for example, take Hollywood. They can't really afford to not do business with China. Like, China's just now a huge, I think the biggest market for them now for movies. Same thing with, I think, a lot of gaming companies. They just can't afford to not do business with China if they want to compete on a global stage. Because, like, China's starting to make movies, and it's only recently that, you know, China's and other countries are, like, breaking through and in some aspects, like, surpassing Hollywood. And like, so it's like, if they want to compete and you're all, it seems like you're all about competition, then it's like, you can't afford to not do business with China.
Well, that's the shame, right? I mean, if it actually is the case that, I mean, this is where I do think government intervention is justified, right? Like, preventing people from doing business with communists, I think is one of the few prerogatives that the government has here. We can't keep doing this. And the terrifying thing is, if we don't have enough power to convince the other Western powers to go along with us and stop selling China the bullets they're going to use against us all, maybe we are sort of on a downward track to oblivion. I don't know how we're going to stop it. There needs to be a significant, like, political.
Yeah, you're advocating for the state.
To stop, in the same way that I think it should be illegal to sell, like, guns and bombs to, like, you know, Al-Qaeda, I think it should also be illegal to sell anything to China.
Or release a movie in China.
Yeah. Anything.
Okay.
Hold on. Can I, Corey? So, recently there was, like, a scandal. I don't know if I should call it a scandal. There was some hubbub. I won't call it hubbub. Over the Star Wars film, that when it was released in China, they took the black guy off of the, like, main character group and put him off in the corner, right? Because Chinese people don't like black people. They're very racist, and they did this specifically for the Chinese market. Right, so you're laughing about this as if it's, like, no big deal, but, like,
I agree.
What I'm kind of curious is that something that you're okay with happening? You're okay with companies doing this in a shrewd decision, you know, to go after profit in a really fucked up country? Like, is that what you're saying?
No. I find it interesting, just that, you know, I'm totally not okay with those things, like, and I'm for, like, pretty much limiting business with China because, like, yeah, I think human rights and ethics should be a more guiding principle. But here is where I guess Lactoid and I will overlap that requires, like, state intervention. And I guess we have some common ground there.
It might, right? I wish it didn't. And if there is a way, you know, Scott talked a little bit about how, you know, for certain businesses, it's just not profitable to operate in China. I think that's great. I love it when, you know, the commies shoot themselves in the foot. That's perfect. But in the situations in which we can't rely on that, that's what I'm concerned about now. I get concerned, like, and we already do this all the time when it comes to certain technologies, right? We're not openly selling rocket technologies to the Chinese, right? SpaceX is not allowed to do business with China in the same way they're allowed to do business with certain countries in Europe or with other companies in America, because they're selling weapons-grade technology, right? They're working with weapons-grade technology. Same reason why weapons companies, weapon manufacturers in the US are limited with who they can do business with, because the idea is we don't want to sell these people something that they're going to use against us. But the issue with this is, I think it's great that we do it with the industries where it's clear, but for decades now, for really two decades specifically, China has grown from being almost nothing to a threat, a serious
something.
Threat. Yeah, a serious threat to everybody. And this is the thing where there's some bipartisan.
That's what we said about. That's Pelosi what we said about Russia. Right. That's what we said about Russia. And Ukraine is right. Kicking Russia's ass. Ukraine is kicking Russia's ass. And that's what we said about Russia.
There's still a body count associated with this.
We piped Russia. I understand the body count, but we piped Russia up way too much. If Ukraine is able to do that against Russia, like, Russia is nothing at this point. And so I'm very hard to believe that China's all of a sudden become this gigantic force that we need to deal with. Take aside nuclear weapons. Take aside nuclear weapons from Russia. Russia isn't shit. Take aside nuclear weapons from China. China's not shit either.
Germany right now is paying the price for not heeding the warnings of being economically interconnected with Russia, right? France did the right thing. They were like, we're just going to go nuclear power. We're going to do our own shit. We're not going to, like, intertwine ourselves with this authoritarian shithole. And they were good, right? They, you know, props to them. Germany didn't listen. And now natural gas is being used as leverage to advance Russia's interest in Ukraine. The idea that China wouldn't do this or wouldn't do something similar when it comes to their national interests, which are obviously imperialistic as well. I mean, think about it. Think how closely our economies are interconnected, right? We just can't deal with them anymore. pull everything out.
Please. But now we can't, at least as far as like we can't afford not to, because they're just that would probably just make them stronger in some sense, or like that would.
So there's
a quote.
Oh, you go first, Scott.
That we don't know if it actually came from Bastiat. It might just be attributed to him. But I think it kind of adequately expresses my issues with Lactoid's proposal to like use the state to stop the business with China. That's when goods don't cross borders, soldiers will. Right. The fact that China is economically dependent upon us and upon the consumer market as well, you know, and like grabs raw resources and like manufactures a lot of things, and we consume a lot of those things. You know, it does present issues to us, our economy. It's certainly a threat in some ways, but the idea that you're going to stop all of that, you essentially isolate China in such a degree that it massively emboldens them to gobble up Malaysia, gobble up Laos, gobble up Vietnam, you know, continue the Beltway Initiative in Africa, and really start to create like a competing empire situation here. So while I do understand that they are horrible state actors that violate rights regularly, I don't know that the appropriate solution to it is to ban companies from doing it. I think the appropriate solution is more freedom, and especially here in the West, so that we can economically outcompete them, as opposed to regulation that forces those jobs into Chinese hands. One of those would be like the minimum wage, for example.
Maybe, sure. And we're not going to disagree on a lot of that stuff, Scott. But, you know, maybe this is an issue of we have to do it slowly. And, you know, it's got to be progressive here. But are you in favor of relaxing the current bans that prevent U.S. companies from selling weapons technology to China?
Right now, so this is a tricky question because, I mean, less state regulation is something I'm morally forced to support. It's not the first thing I would do, right? It's not the first thing, but I would have to bite the bullet I would be okay with that. The only way that I would be okay with that is that if it doesn't exacerbate another violation, which is all of the tax money that is being spent to support said companies. So the only way that I would support that is if the Pentagon and the DOD and the taxpayers stop spending the hundreds of billions of dollars to prop up these companies in the first place. If it was a totally free market enterprise, then yeah, sure. I would say they could sell to whoever the fuck they want to sell their technology.
Wouldn't that just encourage them to sell more to China?
Because they have to.
In the United States?
Yeah, I have no problem with that.
What would your first choice be then?
We have to stop. My first and only choice would that we would have to stop funding them with taxpayer money first. So long as we're taxpayer funding these companies, then no. But if we're giving them specific contracts, like one of the ones that I love to bring up all the time is the ACC Picatinny deal, where it's $350 million that the Pentagon gave to a lot of these companies so that they could supply arms and munitions to rebel groups in the Middle East and North Africa, which is still currently happening, so that we can have more war and conflict so they can make more money, right? Like if you stop all of that funding, I don't really see an issue with any weapons manufacturer selling guns to anybody.
Wait, but I think that them not having the funding and then also not being banned from selling overseas to our enemies.
They will sell to the Chinese.
Or the North Koreans.
Free market, baby.
Someone else.
I don't care.
Okay. Well, maybe this like represents a difference. I care. I care.
They sell weapons to the Chinese that the Chinese were going to fucking steal anyways. And we get money for it and our economy does better. Wing bang, you know, like, thanks. Awesome. We fucking come out ahead from where we're already.
So you think
that actually work?
You think the Chinese
send a nuke to the United States or
you think the Chinese
or force across world?
You think the Chinese government should have American technology in their military?
Do I think the Chinese government should have American technology? No.
Yes.
Because I don't think the Chinese government should exist.
Okay, so why are you supporting the selling of American technology to China?
Because I'm not a consequentialist. I'm worried about what rights are being violated.
Yeah, it's just that
morally he has to agree to that because that's his moral framework.
So even if you had like an expansionist fascist dictatorship,
do you have any idea how wildly different the American economy and state would be if first we dismantled all taxpayer funds towards weapons manufacturers? Like you're talking about a completely different world in that point.
No, yeah, I think much worse one. And then all these companies that that we've defunded in the United States ship their missiles and shit overseas to our enemies who want to come and take pieces of the United States away because we're no longer a functioning country. Like that seems like a bad idea.
Well, you know, I know to a fascist who's made nothing but fascistic beliefs present here over and over and over and over again. Every time we have a panel, I understand why you don't want a weakening of the prison military industrial complex.
Scott, I don't know. I don't know if this is like a topic. Fascist, right?
So
I mean,
should we sell U.S. technology
thing is fascist.
Be super clear. I am a
Scott.
Fascist.
Scott, I'm trying to figure this out.
I'm absolutely a fascist.
I'm trying to figure this out. So, Scott, do you think that the American companies that produce American technology for our military, do you think they should be selling that same technology to the Taliban-run Afghanistan?
No, I don't think they should. Should is an odd question. What the original question was would I support deregulation of businesses selling things? And I said the only way that I would support said deregulation is if we completely decoupled the taxpayer from these.
So you would allow
anarchist. How is this surprising to you? Get it through your thick fucking skull. I'm not lying when I say I'm an anarchist.
I agree with that.
He's not a consequentialist. He's not really thinking about the terrible consequences of his shitty ideology.
Well, so
I don't think you're thinking about the wonderful consequences of finally destroying the prison military industrial complex in America.
Okay, so like libertarianism is a big tent party, okay? Scott, I respectfully disagree. I think the idea of selling communists the weapons that they intend to use against us is bad policy for a couple of reasons.
What if their weapons are lollipops?
Yeah, maybe it's a little bit consequentialist to me, but like, you know, in the same way that we can break it down to like an individual level, right? If I walk up to somebody who's, you know, shaking and saying, I'm going to kill him. And then I pull out a handgun and I say, hey, $100, here you go.
What if it's a lollipop they pull out?
Or a gun that shoots lollipops.
Pedo and he needs a lollipop to lure over a child, right?
All right. There's no Mr. Girl fans anymore. They're all
you know he's going to use it for that. Like, would you still sell it to him?
You can't be an accomplice. Like, there's a level in which there's a legal level in which.
Why would I sell candy to a fucking pedo? Like, I would try and stop the pedo.
Why would you sell fucking missiles to China?
I never said that I would.
But you'd allow them to do it. So you wouldn't personally sell the candy. But you'd allow the guy standing next to you to do it, so long as you didn't touch it.
I wouldn't fucking allow... We would be going after the pedo, because the pedo is a fucking evil, horrible person. But yes...
Wait, but don't you like states?
Candy,
how are you supposed to go after...
I'm not going to make candy illegal, because a fucking pedo in a van
candy. You can't sell candy to pedophiles if you know they're going to use it to lure children into the house. Like, it seems pretty straightforward.
We've gone down this rabbit hole before of where you randomly and arbitrarily make laws, right? The fact of the matter is that people are either free to engage in voluntary transactions and associations, or they aren't.
Yeah, they're obviously
freedom to engage in voluntary transactions.
And I think most reasonable people are for having restrictions around when they can do that.
No, we'd be going after pedos. Pedos are criminals. The non-aggression principle doesn't apply to them. Why? Because they violated the non-aggression principle.
Wait, but how do you... Don't you need a state to go after pedos then?
What? No.
Then how do you go after them?
Wait, okay, maybe this is like too... Okay. So what if I sell ropes, right?
Think,
that's my job.
You think it's impossible? You think it's impossible?
Let's say I saw rope in Toronto, like duct tape and shit, right?
I mean, without a state, maybe.
And the guy comes into the store and he's like, "Hey, I need some rope and duct tapes, rope and duct tape." And I know this man is a pedophile, right? I'm not taking part in any kind of pedophilia, or I'm not going to help him go track down the child. But I know he's probably going to use this to track down the child and hurt the child, right? So you said that I shouldn't face some kind of consequence for selling him this thing that I know he's going to use to hurt another person?
I think you're a piece of shit. I think other people shouldn't do business with you. I think people should ostracize you. But I think engaging in a voluntary transaction is, there's nothing wrong with that.
I see.
Now, the pedo, we should go and hunt down.
Without a state, right?
I see.
Joe, like, if you want me to crush the ever-loving shit out of you on anarchism, we can do that, but I don't think it has much to do about Google censorship in China. Like, if you want me to take over the panel and explain rights enforcement agencies and the structures of hierarchy and the non-aggression principle, like, I can do that, but it's just going to become the Fabian Liberty show.
Sure. Like, I mean,
it's going to be silly.
That's not it. That's not it now.
What?
I mean, is that not what's happening right now? But, okay. Well, all right.
What's
good.
What's happening right now is Fabian has been brave enough to set down his flagpole, right? And because none of the lefties on this panel are speaking out against China or in favor of China or whatever, we're now forced into Fabian's playpen to talk about anarchism again. So unless you guys would like to set out a flag of your own,
it's not my fault that like they're fucking just sitting there quietly. Yeah, like, I don't know which side I'm on, and like fucking you ask me a question about my philosophy.
Well, I don't know if that is a.
I mean, I feel like it's weird that we have to. I don't defend China, but I don't think it's because of communism. That's what I've kind of been like. I don't consider China to be a communist country, and that feels like a boring line to go down.
Why is China not a communist country?
That's the boring line. I don't feel like going down. That was why quiet was preferable. I think that by every standard of the
well, Bam, do you think American companies should be able to do business in China?
You made the statement now. Like,
oh wow, so far.
yeah. But Bam, Doobie's question: do you think American companies should do business in China?
Not just like should they do it? Should they be allowed to do it?
Right.
Be careful. I saw you wearing Nikes one day, Bam. You might be walking into a trap here. Okay.
Literally.
Why do you think I wear Adidas?
Because. I like cheap shoes and
oh yeah, true.
Capitalism
strikes again.
True house capitalist.
This is
stay black, brother.
So, unironically, I think this demonstrates the market failure. This demonstrates why we are selling ourselves into death, into slavery.
No,
right?
No, we are. We're a market failure.
Tell Kevin Durant to make less nicer shoes, bro.
A market failure is supposed, even though I don't believe in the existence of them, to only exist on a free market. When you are talking about state issues and the state's involvement in the market, it is not a market failure in any way, shape, or form.
So I'm talking about not necessarily in terms of the decision of state actors. I guess the state's buying the guns or buying the industry because that's what they do.
Yeah, it's socialism.
I'm talking about the fact that companies willingly choose to do this because it's good to make money. And the fact that we have a profit incentive here for something that will undermine the very foundation of capitalism, it's self-defeating, right? It is, in my opinion, it's a self-defeating. You're setting yourself up for failure.
Well, yeah, actually, there's a market incentive to promote communism, to give money to communism.
Yeah, I thought this is like the same thing on Twitch.
That's not a market failure, right?
There's a market incentive to support communists, and it's no problem.
Again,
that's not true. No one falls balance.
Just like 12 seconds of actual thing. Like, I think it's actually really beneficial for the globe as a whole, for the United States and China to have be so tied to our trades. Like China or America being like. Isolationist is good for no one. I'm a really big believer in multilateral trade agreements, and I'm a really big believer in like the global economy and everyone being connected in some way, even China.
I think Google is proving that wrong, right?
I think as China becomes
more authoritarian, it's not profitable or good for Google to be there, and I think that's probably true of most businesses. The problem that I fear is that the reward. The entire point of profit, right, in an evenly rotating economy is just interest paid for land and labor because, people prefer things now as opposed to the same thing later, right? So you get paid profit because you have the capital to invest to give those goods and services to people right now. And when we aren't in an evenly rotating economy, you know, proper resource allocation is also the reward for it, profit is the reward for that. And I think it's bad resource allocation to be doing any business in China right now. I think it's a dumb move for short-term gains that will ultimately defeat your company if you're consistently doing business in a country that's getting exceedingly more aggressive and exceedingly more abusive towards private property rights. That being said, the fear that I have is that we're not in a capitalist nation. Instead, we're in a mixed market economy with socialism. And I worry that companies know that they can stay here until it collapses and the American taxpayer will bail them out. That's what really scares me, is that just like the 2009 financial collapse, where they were engaging in corrupt bullshit, they knew at the end of the day that the taxpayer would be there to pick up the pieces from their horrible business practices. And so ultimately, I think if we were more capitalistic, we would probably not be in China, because it's a bad idea for most businesses to be there. There's no reason we can't be making shoes in Bangladesh, right? Like, they're already set up for the ready-made garment industry. There are plenty of places that you could be doing this business that aren't in an increasingly abusive and authoritarian state, such as China. So I think if they continue down this path, I don't want to say that the problem will necessarily fix itself, but I think you will see more divestment from China, which may kind of increase the behavior and tendencies of the CCP.
I hope you're right, because I think that's the only realistic solution here. I don't think we're going to be banning all trade from China anytime soon. I don't think the rest of the world would follow us, even if we did. I think we could make some progress when it comes to, you know, tariffs against China, like we saw during the trade war, or, you know, certain industries being banned. I think, again, as any kind of restrictions against business with, you know, communist authoritarian countries, I actually do support. But if you're right, and then just long, you know, over the long term, this problem is going to solve itself. I mean, that's the best kind of problem. You know, Google doesn't want to do business in China anymore. Let's say, you know, next year, Nike doesn't want to do business in China anymore either. I'll be more than happy at that for the problem to solve itself. I'm just concerned if it liberal. Doesn't.
I just don't understand. Like, I'm just super milquetoast liberal. And even I get annoyed by this authoritarian communist, like, comment. Like,
that's not true, man. I've seen you in Clubhouse.
They're putting people in camps, and they're making them work in Xinjiang, and it's terrifying. And we're funding it.
I think those right. things are bad. I don't understand why you ask me.
So
like,
okay, here's okay.
Well, I mean, this is the second time you've been on, like, they're not here's, really here's communist.
I wanna go to this thought. Like, so a lot of the thinking from the American political system, we opened up trade with China, was that, yeah, they're bad. They're doing awful things. But it is the trade
Air Force
context
wants.
With the West that will change them, right?
Moderating force.
Yeah, yeah, exactly that. Moderating force that we will have on them, right? They trade through getting our goods, through getting our media, they will experience the superiority of our culture, of our way of life, whether they actually have a revolution or not, that's something different, but at the very least it would have an effect on China and move them to a less extreme positions. That seems to not have been the case, at least far as I can tell. And it seems to be that we end up undermining ourselves. So, like, in terms of our values, right? Like, businesses, especially when it comes to money, businesses will choose profit over anything else. And so, while they might speak here, they'll run an ad here about how they love, I don't know, diversity or free speech or whatever the fuck, right? When they go over to China, the money's just too good. It's just too good. It seems like we are undermining ourselves by doing business with China. Do people agree with that? That, like,
yeah, I absolutely agree.
I think
you could even say this far back.
What happens
like
when you have socialism in the economy? Like, when you have socialism
when
in the economy,
God,
you
Scott. Let him go.
You enter. You interject low, you interject high time preference into economic affairs. When the more capitalist we were, the less the more capitalist, if we were more capitalist, sorry, we would be doing less business in China. The fact of the matter is that regulatory capture, it makes perfect sense, because the entire idea behind profit is just like I said, it's proper resource allocation and interest. But the more socialism that you interject into an economy, the more that regulatory capture is a means of making profit, of utilizing state power. One of the big reasons that people move over their manufacturing to China is because of the minimum wage laws. We didn't have a minimum wage laws. We could just as easily have cheap factories the southern border where individuals were making $2 an hour.
So I have a question.
How having less socialism in the economy or being more capitalist would fix this thing that I'm about to bring up.
Well, that's the question I was going to ask, because I'm trying to find the socialism.
You could see this is like, I'm sure there's more there's early examples right out there, but the thing that I remember seeing first was Fight Club. Well, Fight Club was released in China, right? Rather than having the ending where all the fucking buildings blow up, right, and they win, quote unquote, rather than having explosion, there's like a screen where text comes up, says, hey, the police found everybody, you know, they put a stop to the plot, nothing exploded, and he ended up in a psychiatric hospital getting medication, whatever. Right, so they totally fucking wipe out the ending of Fight Club. So how does being more capitalist or less socialist in the United States fix that issue, which is a company saying, hey, we want to release this money in China because it's going to make us money. To do that, we need to undermine the fucking point of the movie, right? And in some way, American values, right? So we're going to do it because we want the profit. Like, how does having less socialism or more capitalism address that?
Okay, so you want me to draw a line between less socialism in our economy to how would Fight Club not be censored in China? I can I can take a guess at it. So if we have
I think that's what Prime's talking about, because rather than them adjusting their mm-hmm. culture to come closer to ours, we're actually moving closer to theirs in a lot of ways.
The Western values take a back seat.
And one of the reasons. Right. And one of the reasons is because of the socialistic tendencies of our economy. So if we had a less regulated, more free economy, China would have less business, right? Would you agree to that or disagree to that?
China would have less what?
Business in general, because they'd have less manufacturing. If let's say we just got rid of the minimum wage. Let's just get rid of the minimum wage.
Yeah.
Right. We get rid of the minimum wage. We can have cheap factories, more jobs in America, more high paying jobs, as well as more low paying jobs and a better immigration policy on our southern border. Right. Now, because there's less manufacturing in China, in order to do trade, they're going to have to become more capitalistic. They're going to have to compete on a more even playing field. And one of the reasons why they get so much money from America and they're able to maintain this authoritarianism, which is a net drain on the economy, is because of the corruption of our economic systems. Again, if we had less, let's say, environmental regulations like cap and trade in the UK, where they wanted to fix the amount of carbon that they had in the environment, but the only thing they did is put a bunch of regulations on their own businesses and then buy shit from China, which actually increased their net carbon. Again, China would have less business. So the less business that China has and the less they're able to take advantage of these situations, the more capitalistic, the more free market, and the more libertarian they would have to become. And so if they were forced to become more libertarian and more free market, their values would, of course, and their culture would, of course, have to adapt to these changes as well. And so I think you would see less authoritarian government control over the population's culture as well as those borders open, as more free market capitalism occurs. And because of this, there would be less censorship by the state towards its culture, because it would embrace this change as opposed to utilizing our own socialist weaknesses in our economy against us for their own profit and gain. So a bit of a wager or a guess.
What do you think is the biggest socialist weakness in the United States currently that capitalism could solve?
The worst one?
The biggest for you. Biggest for you.
Probably taxation. Just taxation and wealth distribution.
Really quickly, I feel like I need to respond to Scott because he, you know, laid out a whole
noise.
And I just want to say that actually, I think what's happened is you were going back a step further than I was, and I think you're correct. I think if I were to look at it from that framework, right, where we took away their economic power,
by attracting the manufacturing jobs back to the United States, so they didn't really have it to lean on. They will need to adjust their economy, and that makes sense. Okay, you're right. You're right.
It would be a it'd be a down for the citizens of America though if we just abolish the minimum wage and people are working for $2 an hour.
If they choose to do that, like why not?
Yeah.
Because $2 an hour is not livable in the United States. Do you think it's livable in the United States?
Agree to do that.
I agree, but when you force someone by all the corporations that have this certain type of job at $2 an hour, and no one's above $2 an hour, and they don't really apply for any other job because they don't qualify for any other job, then they're forced to take a $2 an hour job, right?
Sounds like they need to get marketable skills so they can use to get better jobs.
So here's an example. Thomas Sowell uses this example in his book, Basic Economics. Mm-hmm. It's a really great example. When he was young, he had a job where his job was to help people find their seats at a movie theater, right? Now, it was a really dumb job that any teenager could do after school or something. But it didn't pay that well because it's a job that has like no skills whatsoever. But it did mean employment. It did mean personal responsibility. And it did mean more transactions in the economy, which meant higher tax revenue, a stronger economy, all those wonderful things, right? Now, once the minimum wage was abolished, once they increased the minimum wage, those jobs started to go away. And the reason those jobs started to go away is that there's a price floor on labor. Right? You can't go below this amount on labor. And so certain jobs that like certain teenagers could do, or someone that's just bored, or someone that's a senior citizen that just wants to do something cool to get out of the house, can no longer do that job, which means less growth in the economy, less transactions, less cool personable things, etc. So when I'm talking about, you know, abolishing the minimum wage, I'm not just talking about factory jobs. I'm talking about a stronger economy overall. But if you want to talk about factory jobs specifically, that's why I kept mentioning over and over again the southern border.
Well, the only time that I would see that just abolishing the minimum wage would be good is for like internships, to where you're making $2 an hour now, but once you actually gain the skills that you need, then you'd actually be able to make a lot more money. I would see it as feasible in that scenario, but in a scenario that someone's just stuck in that $2 wage gap, or sorry, that $2 wage, I don't see that as feasible, nor do I see it as a moral philosophy to hold, to just keep people in like a $2 wage.
Well, if they're getting $2 an hour, they probably can't afford to buy any like food or anything from the local stores. So it sounds like the stores would also need to lower their prices so these people can actually afford this shit.
Do you think the stores are actually gonna lower the prices because someone makes $2 an hour?
Well, hold on, not just somebody. You're talking about you're seeing like a majority of people in the area.
Supply and demand equation. What are you talking about? But second, let me just lay out a scenario. Maybe it needs to be in a narrative form for you to get kind of what I'm saying, right? So let's say at the southern border, there's a factory, right? And in this factory, they pay $2.50 an hour for just like the regular baseline factory position. Now, $2.50 an hour is not a livable wage in America, but it is south of the border, okay? And so what ends up happening is because that factory is there, less companies are incentivized to move over to, let's say, China or somewhere else, because now there's a cheaper alternative where they don't have to ship things from China. So they can actually afford to pay slightly more than if it was in China. And then what ends up happening is, well, that factory isn't just $2.50 an hour people, right? There's mechanics. Well, they got to get paid. There's, you know, someone that's a manager. They got to get paid. There's an HR person that probably needs to speak fluent English and Spanish, right? So that they can hire people. That person's going to get paid. There's someone that's in charge of the factory, et cetera, et cetera. And so there are some high skill, high wage positions that instead of going to China are now here in America, which increases our wealth and increases our income and pay. But not only that, there are people that can work and live that's better and more prosperous to Mexico. And at the same time, there are some people that will study hard, learn English, work at the factory, maybe go to night school, and they'll become a manager. They'll become some other higher paying job. And we can integrate them into American society because of those factory positions. And it's a net boon for everybody. So it's not like I don't understand your argument against that as a supposed conservative.
My argument against that is that there's going to be people that are stuck in the $2 an hour wage. You are saying that they're not going to get stuck, they're going to move up to manager. That doesn't happen to everybody. Not everybody moves up to manager. They're going to be okay, but what I'm saying, you implied that they would move up to manager, that people move up to manager, and that they would make a higher wage. You're implying that this would immediately lead to a higher wage, whereas I'm saying that it wouldn't immediately lead to a higher wage. As a matter of fact, there would be people stuck in the $2 an hour wage, and that would just... That is not going to be any way, shape, or form livable.
Well, you repeated what I said, except without actually saying what I said in a straw man. First, so we'll just dismiss with your entire argument.
Go ahead. Here. Okay, so explain to me how $2 an hour would be livable. Explain to me that.
I just said it was very simple. It's livable in Mexico. If you're commuting
across
the country, it's livable in
Mexico. The United States are two very different places. Okay.
That was funny.
Yeah. If we want to
backtrack, that's fine. But
that's funny.
I'm not backtracking. You're just too stupid to listen.
Yeah. I want to ask, do you think, as much as I would agree with it, Scott, do you think that implementing very good, solid libertarian ideals in the U.S. economy will be enough to undermine a country with more than four times their population and with direct access to a tremendous amount of natural resources that we don't have?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because when you talk about resources, you're talking about natural resources, right? But the thing is that our mind is also a scarce resource, right? And so if you have a stronger economy and a better educated populace, then it absolutely can defeat a country that's just limiting itself to cheap slaves in middle China that have shit education systems. And they,
right, now you just move the cheap slaves to the United States.
What?
And also, China's still educating their population. Like, in terms of, like, they're not, not exactly.
Yeah, we're pretty big dumb in America.
The individuals that are working in fucking, like, iPhone factories for fucking slave wages are not a well-educated population. Yeah,
they still have
in Beijing.
Would you make that those
people living in Beijing?
No, they still train, and like it's not like it's not
why
China's
can't we
like
make iPhones at the southern border with a bunch of Mexicans? What the fuck is the problem
with
that?
Because it's Mexico and not America? Question mark. I'm really confused here, but I love how this is going.
But it's not like China has no universities or no higher education. Like they are still they're still in academia in China. They're still training engineers just as qualified. There are engineers who train in China that come to America to work as well. Like
I love the leftists that refuse to put a fucking flagpole down, as Doobie described it, and like actually have a position and just wait for me to say something and then try and
wait. You keep talking.
I see the dialectic at fucking work, and that's amazing.
I've been consistent from the beginning. I said I'm not sure. I think I aligned with Lack. I even highlighted earlier. It seems like I have common ground with Lackwood in terms of I recognize that China's a problem. Do I know exactly what to do with it? I have no problem conceding that I don't know exactly what to do about that. Does Lactoy know exactly what to do about that?
Yeah, look, I have a stronger economy
is better for everyone. It's really that simple, that a freer market is better. And that obviously a freer market is an incentive towards new things. If we had a freer market, we would have a better educated population. Absolutely. If we had a better educated population, maybe companies like Intel and AMD wouldn't be so nervous, especially with all the fucking regulations that we have, to build additional foundries here in the United States instead of Germany, Israel, and Taiwan.
Would people who make $2 an hour be better educated?
Sprouticus, you're too
fucking stupid. It's a simple question.
Say it again. Right? Yeah, say it again.
Are you going to answer the question again. Or are you going to...
I can give you a policy, Corey.
I answered the question and laid it out for you.
Go ahead.
I would like you to answer the question. How would someone who's stuck making $2 an hour be better educated? Answer the question. How would they be better educated?
I'll try one more time to rescue the topic. Okay, one more time is foolish, I know.
Apparently everyone just wants to fucking talk to me tonight, PrimeCayes.
You're charming, you make such dumb statements, you draw people in, you got a magnetic personality, it's only natural, right?
Prime, can I quickly answer Corey's question before you put us back on track?
Sure.
Let me go to bathroom.
Sure, go ahead, please.
Thank you.
I'll actually be right back as well. Sorry.
My policy is as follows, and it would apply to Google as well, and really any kind of company. Any company, so yeah, free market, liberalize it, with one exception. The one exception is we're going to pass the Communism is Danger Act. And with this
I'm pro-Communism United.
So you're not gonna like this act. It's gonna outline a list. You know how Obama had a list of countries that, you know, he didn't want, like, immigrants coming, and then Trump later implemented that list. This is gonna be a list of countries that we don't want to do business with, right? Countries that are communist, right? So I'm thinking, you know, China, right? You know, is Russia really communist? They're bad enough. Okay, they go on the list as well. And every company that does business with these countries gets a 5% increasing over time every year, some small amount every year, tax. And that amount gets put into a fund, which helps subsidizes their relocation to free countries. And then over time, we will eventually divest from all these hellholes, and it'll be perfect.
And I can see some, I'm not necessarily opposed to that. I could see, but some might label you as a monster for advocating that type of, you know, state intervention and taxation.
Scott,
I'm not isolated. Hey, Corey, you're gonna drive me insane. Actually, as you say, some might say this, or I don't know if this. Like, stake a fucking position. Like, what do you believe? Firm stance on something.
I believe that yes, China is a problem, and that something should be done. And I have no problem saying that. I don't have the
Do you like my policy?
That's why I asked Lactoid. Like, I can see that can work or potentially work. Or I'm not necessarily strictly opposed to that idea.
I'd be a great politician. Just saying.
You're not strictly opposed to it, but are you in favor of it?
In favor? Pardon me.
Yeah. Well, I want you to like take a firm position on something for once, please. I'm begging you, because I think Scott's right. Right. So. Typically what you and others do, not on every topic, but on most topics, I think, is rather than stake a position, you wait for somebody else to take a position, and then you like needle them from the sidelines when they slip up or say something that you think you might be able to get them on, right? Which is respectable. I commend you. I do that sometimes too. It's really fun. But I would just like, you know, you're a smart guy. I'd like to know what you think about things. That's it.
Okay. Well, first of all, fair enough. I appreciate that, I guess. But I have no problem conceding that I don't think it's completely black and white, at least not to me. I'm not a pure consequentialist, even though Scott might label me as a pure consequentialist. I'm not a pure, you know, virtue ethicist either. I think some elements can work depending on the context. And so if you want my exact answer of like, in this particular instance of this particular issue, like, do I think, again, I guess I'm repeating myself, of like some action should be taken towards China? Because, like, yes, what China does, how it conducts itself, and all the things that the West has to do to acquiesce to China is a huge problem. And that I generally want to cultivate Western values more than many of the
So do you think that private businesses in the West should be banned from doing business with China?
If we want to try that out, I have no problem trying that out. I have no problem expressing the concern that might incentivize, like, if we're going to isolate China, that there might be some ramifications that we haven't thought about. But like, yes, I'm all for it.
So that's one policy. Now, the other suggestion was that, hey, we actually need more capitalism. We need more freedom within the United States so that China loses its economic muscle, right? So we were able to suck back some of this economic muscle that they've stolen from us over the years because of our socialist quote unquote policies. Now, do you agree with that? Like, what issues do you have with that idea?
So I'll take a more, I guess, philosophical direction in terms of like, in terms of the values that capitalism tends to espouse, or like the values that tend to go along with capitalism. I think there are dire consequences associated with that in terms of a free market, and you being turned into a consumer and materialistic values. Those have very detrimental outcomes to humans.
So my question is this, Corey, would you be for or against abolishing the minimum wage?
I would be against. I would strictly be against abolishing the minimum wage.
Right. Roger. Got it. But you recognize that those jobs are being done somewhere for that wage, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So why is it that you just want a pretty little notion of your country not having those bad wages, but you're okay so long as it's just Chinese people doing
it? No, I never said it. I was okay with China having that. At least I don't think I did. If I so did, you, then I will provide.
You think there should be a global minimum wage?
I'd have no problem with that either. Potentially, yeah. Like, as so in, if it's good for the United States and Canada, why not the rest of the world?
So you do realize that once we have a global minimum wage, that's just going to be a massive price increase that will eventually even out towards the people that are making at the lower end of the distribution something relative towards the increase of wages for other people, right?
You got to keep in class. Like the middle class in Mexico is like $19,000 a year, and they're able to live off that just fine. Right, so.
It depends on where you live. It just needs to be livable.
So let me clarify. I'm not saying like whatever a $20 minimum wage should be a $20 minimum wage in Mexico. When I say global, as in like, do I think every country should have a minimum wage that is like reasonable in terms of like a livable wage? That would be my answer. Not a global, all the exact same dollar value.
Can I ask a clarifying question, Corey?
Yes.
Are you saying that global minimum wage, it sounds like, or rather I'll just make a statement. It sounds like global minimum wage to you is that each country should have some standard of a minimum. Is that what you're trying to say?
A global livable wage would probably be the better phrasing. Yeah.
I agree with what Corey is saying. Corey is basically saying that according to where you live, that the minimum wage should be livable. You should be able to live off the minimum wage and not have to like try and beg for money to just try and live. So I agree with Corey. I think that like in Mexico, the minimum wage may be much different than the United States. Actually, state to state inside the United States, it should be much different. Off of like the price of living.
Yeah. Who do you feel should be responsible for setting what livable is? Is it something that each like individual country does, or do these countries create some kind of like authoritative body that sets like a level of standards or something different?
See, that's where you got me. I don't know who should be in charge of this.
That might be something.
Yeah, it's like a spitball idea, obviously, because we're all like our brains are kind of tiny on this. It's not our job to set these type of things, but just kind of wondering where you're at.
Everyone's brain is kind of tiny on central planning. It's the economic calculation problem.
Okay. Anyway, so what are you saying, Corey?
I foresee it probably something similar to what Canada does in terms of like the Quebec minimum wage is different than the Ontario minimum wage, as in it's probably best left up to the state actors that actually have a better idea of the boots on the ground of what's going on locally.
I mean, to say that anybody can live off of $2 an hour is just kind of silly. Because, I mean, that...
There is some place in the world where you can.
I mean, but in America, that would equal, like, less than $4,000 a year. And considering it's about $1,000 for the cheapest apartment in most places for even a studio apartment, you're looking at not being able to even do that for...
Well, I live in Indiana. I live in Indiana. $1,000 a
month for a studio is only in fucking expensive cities.
I live in Indiana. I pay $800 a month for my mortgage. I live in Indiana, but though, so like the vast amount of difference there actually is between states is for my mortgage.
Even with $800 for a mortgage, you wouldn't be able to do that with $2 an hour.
No, I agree. I agree with what you're saying, but what I'm saying is even in the United States, the cost of living is vastly different between states.
Send me some Zillows, Sprout. Jesus Christ.
So I pay $400 for my mortgage.
Stop!
Inclusive of everything.
God damn, fucking Republicans, bro. That's
for a house, right? I mean, yeah, you get to the Midwest.
Fucking Republicans flanking the left on houses, bro.
It's like $1 million Canadian.
Well, and Scott's right.
Bad economics.
Yeah, minimum wage only leads to unemployment and inflation.
People are paid for the value of their labor. Period.
Well, according to you.
Like, it's just basic economic theory. Like, people are paid for the value of their labor. If you just start artificially increasing how much they're making, all you're going to do is make goods and services more expensive. And because those goods and services are more expensive, the value of the dollar that they have goes down. And then you're constantly using central planning and wasting money out of the economy to try and chase this fucking issue. What I'm saying is that when you put a minimum wage in, what you do is that you force certain jobs out of the market, obviously. And when you force jobs out of the market, you slow growth, you slow GDP, and you, like, I don't understand, like, this is just mind-boggling how fucking stupid these takes are.
Because like, we can live in an economy where we like or you can have like other priorities. Like, but like we can have which seems like most countries decided that we can have a buy-in. They're like, hey, you know what? Even if there's probably something more hyper specifically like profitable we can do, we can all just pitch in a little bit to make sure that like people aren't actually homeless. And like, that costs is like,
no, these people want a fucking minimum wage so that when they walk outside, they don't have to see anything bad in the world. And they can think that the world's fucking pretty while they're picking up their goddamn iPhones that are made from fucking slave labor of people that are literally beaten, raped to death in Africa by Chinese slave owners.
We're just making some shit up.
Wait a minute. I got you, but let's just.
I'm not making shit up. Like, do you think conflict medals?
Understand. Wait a second. I want him to deal with that first part. Do you think that it's okay for a society to decide that, hey, the buy-in to this society is that we all pitch in so that people aren't homeless? Do you think that that's something a decision a society can come to?
I mean, if individuals want to voluntarily associate...
No, not individuals, but society. I'm saying like that...
I don't think... society is not a person. I've never met society.
I know, I'm not talking about a person. That's why I'm making that distinction.
The size of a
I believe in individual rights. I don't believe in some amorphous organization that uses violence and coercion.
Wait, what was the first part? Wait.
The fucking will of the people.
Wait, what was the first part? Oh, I missed you on the first half. I'm going to laugh. What'd you say?
Oh, no.
You don't believe that like there can be a buy-in? You don't believe that like a decided, like if you want to live here, these are the types of things that, these are part of our rules.
I already said that if you want to voluntarily do things and you have rules based off of that voluntary association, I'm fine.
Right, but that would be called being a country. Like that, like you voluntarily associate to be here. Like you're like, oh,
if
I'm
everyone voluntarily
here.
Associates and there's no theft and there's no violation of the non-aggression principle and they set themselves up collectively and they come to some decision, that's not a state and that's not a country. That's a covenant community.
But if you have children that are born in that country and they're like, oh, I don't want to do that, then they would say, like, if you want to live here, you still have to do this stuff.
Right. And so if you're imposing things upon people,
they would either have to leave or like they didn't choose to be in this country. They were born into this country. So you're saying that
make a choice when you come of age.
Yeah, exactly. So you would say that like, oh, okay, these are the rules. And if you don't want to participate in those rules, you can leave.
Yeah. You can divest, and they should allow you to divest.
What if you don't have the money to divest?
All we're talking about is
you don't have the money to divest. Sucks to be you.
That's right. You fucking die.
So for the more like consequentialist people here, I mean, the Biden's own White House report admitted that a minimum wage increase would lower the GDP and raise unemployment. There's also other studies that show that any raises in the minimum wage also increase crime, property crime. By as much as 2%.
Unless minimum wage is localized. If minimum wage is localized, it wouldn't do that. It's talking about a national minimum wage. Minimum wage should be localized. It should not be done via the federal level.
Referring to a federal minimum wage, yeah. But that's generally what people talk about when they talk about raising the minimum wage.
Yeah, I'm saying like, Sprout, I agree with you on that, but the reality is, like, this was only an issue because other states and cities and local, like, they don't actually address this issue. Like, I'm from the state of Georgia. Like, if they, like, our technical minimum wage is $5.15, but that would, like, if they actually address that issue on the state level, maybe we wouldn't have to have a federal minimum wage.
It is invariable. It is just a fact of reality that if you increase minimum wage, you price certain jobs out of the market. There's no way you can argue yourself out of that. Once you price certain jobs out of the market, right, that means that you have less of a demand for labor. And so the price demand equation of labor must then fall. It devalues the wages of everyone when you increase minimum wage. You just say some magic shit and say, we must make this certain amount of money, except you don't have a fucking commodity currency. You have fiat currency, and then it gets away from you, and then you devalue that labor. And once you devalue that labor, everyone's purchasing power goes down. It fucks over the people and the economy, and it makes the rich richer.
I don't care about this. I'm saying that even after that, let's say that we didn't do that, and we still decided we're going to come up with some, again, this is a magic libertarian world. We're going to come up with some, crazy idea where, like, people pitching like a money from their wages that aren't minimum wage to make sure that people who had to work for $2 an hour could afford to live in the economy. Like, all right. Again, voluntary.
Mutualism. We run out of time for whatever the fuck it was I planned for this.
For right? Google and China. Yeah,
right.
Dude, whatever. I tried to bring it back to China.
Yeah, I know. I talking about slave labor. I like, get fucking... it. I hear you.
Right? More so the rape, but you know, it's okay.
The force of your magnetism is more powerful than topics.
Sorry, Magneto. Your cell phone's bought off of rape.
Okay. So let's.
What do you use? What phone do you use, my friend?
Scott, it folds.
Next topic. Before we do that.